I've never lost a photo in 15 years with this trusted Lightroom strategy. Import, curate, backup, edit. The perfect catalog can exist, and I'll show you how. Later in this video, I'll show you the power of Lightroom Smart Collections and how I use them to great effect in my catalog. I use one Lightroom catalog for everything. This catalog contains every photograph I've ever taken. I'm quite ruthless when curating my photos, and I currently have just over 40,000, but that amount would be in the millions if I wasn't ruthless. I find it easier managing just one catalog, and I don't like keeping photos if I don't need to. I store all photographs in one master folder on an external hard drive. Folders are then broken down into years and then into respective trips. Each trip folder is labeled with the year, month, and location. If a trip falls over multiple months, I use the date the trip started on. I store my Lightroom catalog on my MacBook Pro's internal hard drive. This ensures Lightroom runs at optimal speeds. Lightroom has many features to help us organize our photos. And before I show you my import and curation process, I want to show you how I use the star ratings, keywords, color labels, and flags. Every photo has a star rating applied. This helps me differentiate between the quality of each photograph. One star is given to photos that have a sentimental attachment, something I'll never use but want to keep. Two stars are given to any usable photos, something sharp, well exposed, and good enough for publication, but not something I would share personally. Three stars are given to photos good enough to share online on my social media channels. This is something that won't make my portfolio, however, but it's worth sharing. Four stars are given to my B-grade portfolio photographs, and five stars given to my A-grade portfolio photos. Five-star photographs feature on my website and represent my very best work. All photos are given two keywords, namely the species type and the location. This helps me find specific species or locations when searching for photographs based on specific criteria. If I am keywording a landscape photo, I purely just keyword landscape. I use color labels to keep track of certain attributes applied to each image. A red label is given to images that have complete edits applied. Yellow labels are given to images with an in-progress edit. This means I'm not finished editing the image. A green label indicates that the image has been edited in full and a title and caption included. I use titles and captions for my portfolio images on my website. Blue labels are given to files that sit underneath a master file in a stack. I call these under master files. Once a new master file has been created and placed on top of an image stack, everything that's hidden underneath, once a stack has been collapsed, has a blue label applied. Examples of under master files can include raw files of a further edited TIFF file and raw files that formed part of a panorama, HD or focus stack. Adding the blue label helps me identify images I can ignore because of a derived master file. Purple labels are given to images that I've submitted to a stock site. I don't supply stock images anymore, and I might change the use of purple labels down the line. You can customize the name given to color labels by clicking on metadata in the top menu, clicking color label set, and then edit. I have customized my image label set like this. To add color labels quickly, use the number keys from 6 to 9. I use flags in the following ways. The pick flag is used to indicate which of my photographs have been exported to my social media folder. I like to keep track of what I've exported to share. You could also use the pick flag to indicate which photos you want to edit. Rejected flags are given to images I want to delete. With that out of the way, let's talk about the four-step system I use for Lightroom catalogs and how I use the previously mentioned attributes to organize my photos properly. My four-step system is simple: import, curate, backup, edit. Step one is to import photos. I'm not going to go into detail on how to import photos. There's a ton of videos on YouTube on how to do that. But when I import, I rename my files, the date in the beginning, followed by my initials, and then the unique four-digit number my camera generated. I rename my files to eliminate any issues with duplicated file names. I apply no keywords or develop settings on import. Once your photos are imported into Lightroom, step two is to curate the photos. This is the most time-consuming part of the workflow, but very necessary to do correctly. The first curation step is to go through all images and either reject the bad ones using key X, one star the sentimental photos, or two star all usable images. We'll add a higher star rating to respective images later on. To add star ratings quickly, use the number keys from 1 to 5. Don't delete any photos at this stage, and make sure to zoom in to check the sharpness of any two-star images. Creating one-to-one previews for the photos can help make the sharpness checking process quicker. To do this, select the images you want to create one-to-one previews for, click Library in the menu, go to Previews, and then click Build one-to-one previews. This will take some time depending on how many previews Lightroom needs to build. Once you've completed this first curation step, filter the folder to show the files that have 2 stars or greater. Now is the time to apply any 3, 4, or 5 stars to the images. Once I'm happy with the curation, I then select all of the rejected files and delete them. Make sure to select Delete from Disk. If you select Remove from Lightroom, the files will stay on your hard drive. After deleting the rejected files, I then add keywords to the files remaining. As mentioned previously, I add the species name and the location only. Once I've curated the entire folder, I add a green label to the folder to indicate that I have finished curating it. In this example of a trip I made recently to the Kruger National Park, I took 4,204 photos. 3 of them are 1 stars, 141 are 2 stars, 45 are 3 stars, 10 are 4 stars, and only 5 were chosen as 5 stars. I rejected and deleted 3,921 photos. You can see the ratio of images I like to keep, and also worth mentioning, it took me about 3 hours to curate this entire trip. The next important step is to back up your Lightroom catalog and your photographs. You should back up your photos immediately after import before the curation process if the curation will take time. You want a second copy of those files as soon as possible. My backup strategy is as follows. My full photo collection exists on a 2 terabyte external hard drive, including the Lightroom catalog backup folder. This is all synced automatically to a Dropbox account online. I then create 3 backup copies of this main 2 terabyte hard drive using file sync software to 3 separate hard drives. The main hard drive is always with me, and I keep my first backup drive with me as well to immediately backup to when possible. I then keep a second backup at my office and a 3rd at a relative's home. This allows me to have 4 copies of my entire collection as well as a collection on the cloud. My photo collection is small, and I find it easy to manage with this simple backup workflow. I try to run these backups as often as possible. Once or twice a month, I backup my Lightroom catalog to my main hard drive that is automatically synced to Dropbox, as well as to my 3 backup drives. I keep the last 3 Lightroom backups only. Once you have curated your images and backed them up, it's time for the editing process. I've got many videos showing you how to edit your photos on my channel, but I want to talk about how I manage these edited photos. When I begin editing a photo, I apply a yellow label. Only when the editing is complete, I change it to a red label. For my website, I like to add a title and description to my photos, and once that is done, I add a green label. These 3 different color labels allow me to identify what has been done to an image. If I want to add a different edit to the photo and retain the original edit, I create a virtual copy and apply the different edit. I then add a color label to that virtual copy depending on the editing stage. If I have a photo that needs further editing in Photoshop, I'll open the image in Photoshop, complete the edit, and then save the file, which then gets imported back into Lightroom. This file gets saved in the same folder as the RAW file. That file from Photoshop now becomes my master file, and I put that at the beginning of the image stack in Lightroom. I then apply a blue label to the RAW file to indicate that this is an under master file. I'm not interested in that RAW file anymore because I have a new master file. As mentioned in the beginning of the video, here is how I use smart collections in Lightroom. I use a set of 9 smart collections to help me look for images quickly. Smart collections show images based on certain criteria. 3 smart collections show me my 3, 4, and 5 star images. The next 3 smart collections show me the images which have a certain edit applied to them, and the final 3 smart collections show me the 3, 4, or 5 star images which are unedited. If anything is unclear about my Lightroom strategy so far, please drop me a comment below and I'll be sure to reply and help you out. So why go through all this work for a perfectly organized catalog? The first reason, so you don't lose anything and stay well organized. The second reason, it's incredibly easy to search for specific images. For example, I can show you all of my lion photos that are 4 or 5 stars that have been edited from the Kruger National Park. This is so helpful when I get a request for licensing. I can literally find anything I want within seconds. Once you've got your photos organized and backed up, it's time for editing. So click on the screen here and check out this video next, as I show you the full edit on this leopard image in Lightroom.